The following program, Long Way to the Top, is rated M for mature audiences. It contains coarse language, drug use, and nudity.
That make up the role of honour in the Great Campaign became part of Hard Rock's own heroic mythology. Melbourne's White Horse Inn, Sydney's Bondi Lifesaver, and Adelaide's Largs Pier Hotel, where another young recruit, Jimmy Barnes, began his journey from fighting and drinking to screaming the blues.
I used to go there when I lived in Elizabeth when I was a bit younger. We'd take acid and go there and watch the bouncers kill people, you know, just for entertainment. It was like frightening. These guys, it was a really rough pub. You know, for all the Sydney bands used to play there. I remember seeing Lobby Lloyd and Billy Thorpe. This place was just outrageous. I mean, everybody had jugs of like bourbon and coke. That was the chicks. They'd have strippers every night. It was like a real full-on bar. It was like Wild West town. And that's where we started. We started drawing crowds there. And the ones that made it through the night without getting killed and came back the next night, you know, and brought their mates for protection.
If there was one band that took the hard-living road warrior ethic to its logical extreme, it was Adelaide's Cold Chisel. Not only did they attack their audiences, they fought amongst each other.
Yeah, Don Walker, who's grew up on Ray Charles, Thelonious Monk, Ian, you know, he's really clever, he's just really soulful, and he just plays. It's a gift from God. It comes straight from, that and his knob. You get me, I was like 14 years old, who wanted to sing, scream like Little Richard. Steve, who was a bloody thick-headed Scouse git, drummer from Liverpool, he's trying to do things really precise, and he's trying to do things really, sweet, and I just want to do things raw and fucking hammer them, and him and I were literally like this the whole time. Let my heart to the Zappos
round casing. If AC/DC set down a solid Australian sound, Cold Chisel songwriter Don Walker found an authentic local voice. Vietnam cold turkey. His lyrics were like bush ballads snuck in the back door of the bar.
He's the social voyeur, I guess. He'll pick an image which will sum up the whole vibe, as opposed to literally saying, this is fuck, this is fuck, this is fuck. He'll sort of say, oh, this is great, but by the way, this is happening, And it's sort of, which is the way life is, All this fuck stuff goes on around you without you even knowing it until you suddenly realize. He's sort of like that. He sees what's messing up before it sort of becomes the bleeding obvious.
AC/DC didn't exactly leave a vacuum back home in Australia, more an opportunity. Jimmy Barnes was King Yobbo, the leader of an eager pack of new bands raging around the pub circuit. It was musical therapy. The unruly crowds became feared the world over, as every night of the week, thousands of venues shook to the national pastime.
I hate the youth, mate, but it's found out that we ain't gonna stand back anymore.
On one infamous night in March 1979, the Hard Rock Revolution came close to the real thing. When fans put on a genuine riot to protest the close down of a classic pub rock venue, the Star Hotel, suburban warfare broke out in the streets of Newcastle.
It's the funniest thing. I still have people coming up to me saying, "We seen you there. We were there with you when that happened. We were there that night when you guys played on that last night." And we never fucking played there at all. Never even went there. I went there once for a drink because I wanted to go see it. I remember the bar, they had these. If you wanted to dance, you danced on the bar, and the band played behind where the drinks are served. It was a great little pub.
For once, rock and roll boozers stopped throwing beer at the band.
That was the first time that it erupted into violence on the street, where people were prepared, so pissed off, they weren't sure what it was about, but they were so pissed off about just the overall gloom of the situation in the country that it erupted into violence. And it was, I think it was something that freaked a lot of Australians out, freaked a lot politically but business-wise and, you know, locally. And I know as an observer, Don Walker was really touched by it, the fact that, you know, that this was like, the Australians who are like, "Oh, she'll be right, mate," were actually turning to burning police cars and out of frustration.
It had become far too rough, tough and tawdry for those in the platform shoes. As rock took a harder turn and audiences followed, the glam acts began to lose their place and relevance.
It was only when we took ourselves seriously that the band started to the wheels started falling off.
Some retired to more suited professions, writing advertising jingles and the challenge of light entertainment television. Even a few pub rockers got the corporate treatment. Jimmy Barnes was dragged outdoors to beat the drum on behalf of the working class man. It was a huge hit.
Cold Chisel, as big as they were, never sold the amount of albums that Jimmy sold on a solo basis. And I think Jimmy had such a wide appeal. And I think one of the things I worked really hard at with him was to really make sure that he did more than scream.
Michael Gudinski even hired a punk to write songs for the working class man. The Saints' Chris Bailey joined Jimmy at his country retreat.
They're very serious songwriters, very serious. Really, you know, like, ponder the songs and sit there. And I'd be like, yeah, give me that fucking thing. There's a lyric. Boom, I'm going to go and water the horse, you know, and then come back, you know. But I could see them, they were like, fucking, what's this guy on? You know, they wanted me to sit down still and do something. But in the end, that's what they do. And I come in and add, excitement.